فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So the author rahimahullahu ta'ala, Imam Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he now goes into al-khabar. The author goes into what is known as al-khabar. And this is the first point he picks up from his book. So I really want you to realize that Ibn Hajar is actually drawing you a diagram. He started from the top, al-khabar. And the diagram, inshallah ta'ala, as it goes, we're going to be formulating the diagram together, inshallah. Inshallah ta'ala, so you can see what's happening here. So let's start writing it. Slightly good job. Okay, we have al-khabar. So Ibn Hajar, he starts the book with al-khabar. So we're going to be drawing the diagram together. Al-khabar. Sorry. Al-khabar. And then the diagram is going to be drawn, inshallah ta'ala, from the statement of Ibn Hajar. Are we all together? So what does al-khabar mean? The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he explains what khabar means in his sharah of Nusatul Nadar. In the sharah of the book. He says, al-khabar is ma'anahu. He says, على دلالة عند المحدثين وعلى الفرق بينه وبين الحديث والأثر. So there's a couple of things that Ibn Hajar does here. First of all, he explains what khabar is. And he also explains the difference between a hadith, a khabar, and an athar. So there's three things that are now. So what's the difference between these three? We have al khabar. We have al-khabar. So we have al. We have al-khabar. We also have al-hadith. We also have al-athar. So what's the difference between these three? Huh? What's the difference between each of these three? We need to go into. So let's start with the first one, which is hadith. Hadith is anything that's attributed to the Prophet ﷺ. We already took it. Hadith is anything that's attributed to the Prophet ﷺ in terms of speech, al-qawl, and al-fi'lu, action, and also the Prophet's taqreer, consent, whether it's hukman, in terms of ruling, or if it's tasrih and directly. Okay, because we have this concept of it's the wording of a companion, but it's given the ruling of the hadith. Okay, so that's why we say hukman or tasrihan. So that's what hadith means. Okay, athar here means, athar is anything besides the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's basically what's attributed to a sahabi, or what's attributed to a tabi'i. That's an athar. It's anything other than the Prophet. What's a khabar now? Khabar involves, and it's more comprehensive than not all. So these two together are khabar. Sahih? Khabar is both of them together. Khabar is a hadith and athar together. Does that make sense? Are we all together? So the hadith is what? The khabar is it's more comprehensive than both of them. يطلق على ما نسب إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وإلى غيره. Anything that's attributed to the Prophet or anything that's attributed to other than the Prophet is known as what? Khabar. So that's why the author rahimahullah ta'ala used the word khabar. I want you guys to ponder on something here right now with me, which is sometimes it does happen though that they are interchangeably used. Sometimes it happens The athar means hadith, and it means khabar, and khabar means hadith, and athar. They're all interchangeably used. They can be each one. Okay? It does happen. And I'm going to give you guys a couple of examples, inshallah ta'ala. One example is the qawl and the statement of Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. Al-Imam Al-Bukhari's statement. When Bukhari said, Ahfadhu, I memorized. Bukhari saying this. Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, what did he say? Ahfadhu, I memorized. Mi'ata alfi hadith. Mi'ata alfi hadith. I have memorized 100,000 hadith. Sahihin, which is authentic. Wa mi'atay alfi hadithin. I've also memorized 200,000 hadith. Ghayra sahihin, which is not authentic. Ponder now. Bukhari says, I have memorized 100,000 ahadith which are authentic. I've also memorized 200,000 ahadith which are what? Which are weak. Ibn Salah, in his kitab, Ulum al-Quran, are you there? He says, هَذِهِ الْعِبَارَةِ قَدْ يَنْدَرِجُ تَحْتَهَا عِنْدَهُمْ آثَارُ الصَّحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ وَرُبَّمَا عُدَّ الْحَدِيثُ الْوَاحِدُ الْمَرْوِيُّ بِإِسْنَادَيْنِ حَدِيثَيْنِ. So when Bukhari said this statement, what falls under his statement of, I have memorized 100,000 hadith, what falls under that is, عِنْدَهُمْ آثَارُ الصَّحَابَةِ. The statement of the companions falls under there as well. وَالتَّابِعِينَ. And also the statement of the what? The tabi'in. So now what has hadith become? It's become khabar, right? It's comprehensive now. So hadith is now being used of the level and the caliber of khabar. Very good. وَرُبَّمَا عُدَّ. And it sometimes may even be counted one hadith if it's narrated with two different chains and it's one hadith, it's going to be called two hadiths. It's not going to be called one hadith. So when Bukhari said 100,000, don't think to yourself, I looked at all of the hadith that are out there and it doesn't even reach 100,000. How did Bukhari come to this conclusion? He's referring to the Sahabas, the Tabi'een. He's also referring to what? One hadith, two different chains, he's two different hadiths. He's counting as two different hadiths. All week. Lala, he would memorize week. These scholars were not just memorizing Sahih, they were memorizing weak narrations as well. So they know it. Why is weak? Who's in the chain is making it weak? They all know the matters pertaining to that. لِذَلِكَ that's why Iraqi makes it in his Alfiyah. وَعَلَّهُ أَرَادَ بِالتِّكْرَارِ لَهَا وَمَوْقُوفًا وَفِي الْبُخَارِ. نعم. That's what Iraqi says in his Alfiyah. Have we understood that point, brothers? Another example. Another example for the same, to just show you that khabar and hadith and athar can interchangeably be used, is the statement of Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah ta'ala. Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, صح من الحديث, what's authentically transmitted in the hadith is 700,000 hadith. He said, in terms of hadith, 700,000 hadith, 700,000 hadith, وكسر and extra has been transmitted. He said, وَهَذَا الْفَتَى. Bukhari, Ahmed ibn Hanbal said, there are 700,000 and extra hadith, a little bit more, that are authentic. وَهَذَا الْفَتَى. And this young boy, who's he referring to as this young boy? Does anyone know who he's talking about? Nah. Huh? No, not his son. Abu Zur'at al-Razi. وَهَذَا الْفَتَى, يعني Abu Zur'at al-Razi. And as for Abu Zur'at al-Razi, he said, قَدْ حَفِظَ 600,000. Abu Zur'at memorized 600,000. He had memorized what? 600,000 hadith. Al-Imam al-Bayhaqi commented this, and you can find it in the kitab Tahdhib al-Kamal. Bayhaqi commented on this, and he said, وَإِنَّمَا أَرَادَ وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ. And he said, what he intended by this statement, Imam Ahmad, Allah knows best. مَا صَحَّ مِنْ أَحَدِيثِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Ahmed What he intended by 700,000 ahadith is the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa aqawil as-sahaba, and also the statements of the companions, wa fatawa man ukhida anhum, and the verdicts of those tabi'in that is taken from. Are you with me, brothers? So here what you realize is that hadith and khabar and athar can interchangeably be used. The final example is qawl Abi Zur'a. Abi Zur'a al-Razi's own statement. He said to his son, Ahmad ibn Hanbal's son, Abdullah. Abu Zur'a al-Razi was sitting with Abdullah ibn Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Abdullah ibn Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. So he's talking to him and he said, Abuka, your father, yahfadhu alfa hadith. Your father memorized a million hadith. So he said, your father has memorized a million hadith with his chains and everything. And then Abdullah, he said, who's the son, Wama yudrika, how do you know that? How do you know my father has memorized that much? Qala dhakartu, I revised with him. فَأَخَدْتُ عَلَيْهِ الْأَبْوَابِ, and I took the understanding and the chapterings of those ahadith. I mean, he organized it for me. So this is what we take from this is what Al-Dhahabi said. Dhahabi said, Sir Alam al-Nubala, the 11th volume, page 186, he said, he said, فَهَذِي حِكَايَةٌ صَحِيحَةٌ. This story is first of all authentic. فِي سِعَةِ عِلْمِ أَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ. This shows how vast the knowledge of Imam Ahmad was. وَكَانُوا يَعُدُّونَ فِي ذَلِكَ الْمُكَرَّرِ وَالْآثَرِ وَفَتَاوَ التَّابِعِي. He said, but they used to consider the repetition of those ahadith. If they repeated so many times on different chains, they will also count that. وَالْآثَرِ, they will also count the athar, which we just took, which is the statement of the sahabas and the tabi'in. They will count that. وَمَا فَصَّرَ وَنَحْوَ ذَلِكَ. They will count that. Are you with me, brothers? Are we all together on that? So now we learned the heading of the top, which is al-khabar, and al-hadith, and al-athar, what it means, what's the definition for it, and the differences of each one. Are we all on the same page? Are we all together? Now we're going to go into, half of the Ibn Hajar is now going to go into Ibn Hajar is going to now go into a point which is very important, which is taqseemu al-khabar bi-wusulihi ilayna. And then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he's now going to draw this diagram for us. Okay, Ibn Hajar, rahimahullah ta'ala. What he says is that al-khabar, and now he goes automatically, is taqseem al-khabar bi'atibari wusulihi ilayna, categorizing the khabar in terms of how it reaches us. In terms of how it reaches us. Are you with me, brothers? Hafiz, rahimahullah ta'ala, he categorized it into two. The first one, he says, "Imma an yakuna lahu turuqun bila adadin muayyanin." Are you there? The first one is, there is no restricted amount of narrators. It reached a level of, it's just too much narrators. That's what mutawatir is. And the second one, which is أو مع حصر, or it's restricted with an amount. Does that make sense? Those are the two, mutawatir and ahad. Mutawatir is a narration where the narrators who have narrated this are not restricted to an amount, meaning it's too much. 50, 60, 70, 80, it's just too much. No one's going to count it. It's unrestricted. The number is just going, it's going on. Okay? And the second one is, and it doesn't have a limit, in the sense where when how much it can become, the highest it can become, it's just unrestricted. This one, on the other hand, is restricted to an amount. The one that's restricted to an amount is called ahad. The minute restriction comes, it's called ahad. Are you with me? Very good. I will speak about it, inshallah ta'ala. Each one. الذي لا حصر لطرقه is called خبر المتواتر. The second one is الذي له طرق محصورة is known as what? أحد. Let's start with the first one. The author says فالأول, the first one, which is what? المتواتر. المفيد للعلم اليقيني. So the author starts with المتواتر. When he says al-awwalu, he means al-ladhi la hasra li turuqihi. As I just mentioned in the matin right now, the one that doesn't have no restricted amount, that one, which is al-mutawatir, al-mufidu, it benefits you, al-ilm al-yaqini. What does it mean, ilm al-yaqini? What does yaqin first of all mean? Yaqin means huwa al-i'tiqadu al-jazim al-mutabiqu lil-waqi'. Yaqin means what? When you have an unwavering conviction in your heart, which is what? It's in correlation with the waqi' in front of you, the reality in front of you. So ilmu al-yaqini, which the author mentioned. So the author, rahimahullah, here, stop here. The author, rahimahullah, what does he say here? He says that al-mutawatir is what? Al-mufid. What does it benefit us? What does it benefit us? The author said. What does it benefit? Read the matter for me. What does he say it benefits us? Lil-ilm al-yaqini, right? Lil-ilm. Al-yaqini, sah? المفيد للعلم اليقيني. So what does it benefit us? علم اليقيني. What does للعلم اليقيني? What does علم اليقيني mean? What does العلم اليقيني mean? It's also known as what? علمه. It's also known as علم الضروري. It's known as also known as what? علمه. علم الضروري. علم الضروري is something you don't need two things. Number one, النظر. Second, you don't need استدلال. There's those two you don't need. You don't need observation. You don't need to observe it. Nor do you need istidlal, nor do you need to look for evidences. You don't. It's reached a point where there's no requirement, there's no need for observation, and there's no need for what? They're looking for evidence. You don't look for evidence. Sahih? Because the people who are telling you are large in quantity, they are large in amount and number, that you as an individual no longer want to know. You don't ask. Sahih? Example, have you seen China? Have you been to China before? Do you believe in China's existence? 100%. No doubt. علم اليقيني. صحيح? This is called what? It's علم اليقيني, certainty. Because you see people coming from China and say, we're Chinese. You see, you saw the news talking about China. You saw this and that. You saw recordings that are coming from those countries. Okay? Even if recording didn't come, but the magnitude of people come from it. And every time, where are you from? China. Okay, where are you from? China. China, China, China. So China does exist. Does that make sense? So now if I was to ask you, where did you find out from China's existence, you would say this is ilmu daruri. I know it out of necessity now. It's obligatory. Does that make sense? This is ilm which is mutawatir. If somebody tells you something, somebody comes up to you and says, Ustadh died. You're like, really? First, it's shocking. No, that's not true. Really? Then another person tells you, another person, when it reaches 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 people, it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. It's certainty now. Sahih. You with me? That's what it becomes. It's here. Ilmul. Ilmul yaqini. This is what mutawatir means. It's a khabar which لا يحتاج منا إلى بحث أو استدلال. It doesn't require researching and looking into the issue and observing. ولذلك, are you there? ولذلك, if you look at today and you observe what atheists want to make evidence, what do they believe is, if you simply ask an atheist today and you say, atheist, what does it take for you to become a believer of God? What would it take for you to believe in God's existence? So what's a proof to you? Seeing God. See, that's their evidence. Good, I like that. Seeing God is what's going to make them believe in God. So they believe in what? Empirical evidence. They believe God has to be seen. Sahih? But that's a contradiction on their side. Why? Because there are many things they believe that they haven't seen. So when do they determine? When do they actually say, no, I won't believe anything unless I see it. We believe in atom. We've never seen atom. Sahih? We believe in so many things that we don't see. Sahih? So basing your belief on seeing alone and saying it's only what is seen is false. It's wrong and it's baseless. Sahih? Walidalika, that's why the religion, there are things that are categorized. So for us, evidence is what? Al-Kitab wa Sunnah. That's our evidence. They're getting confused. They're jumping from one theory to another theory to another theory to another theory to the theory. And to be honest, I tell you one thing. This is something that's known by Islamic history, known by reading the books of the when philosophy came and introduced into Islam, that all it brought about was confusion and people who indulged themselves into it without having any knowledge of Nususul Wahyain, they came out confused. And they came out not knowing anything. Fulan said this in his book. Fulan believes this theory. Oh, see daisy, the theory is now demolished. It doesn't exist. There's a new theory out. Okay, this is what's being used. Template. This is, okay, oh, that doesn't exist anymore. And that's what your life is going to be. There's nothing which is jammed. There's nothing which is concrete. Does that make sense? So it's very vital and it's very important that we realize that the knowledge of types, the ilm that we have and knowledge that we have, that we believe in things, let's not fight against it. Okay? Some things are just known out of necessity. Questioning that thing is a logical absurdity. So, it's junoon. Questioning it is actually what? It's actually junoon. So those same people, if you were to ask them, what does it take for you to believe in God? For them, they say science is. Does that make sense? Science is what believes in our foundation of saying that God does exist. It has to be empirical. It's science. Science is what can determine if God exists. And the truth of the matter is the principles that you place in science today may never not live for tomorrow. So if you say today, I believe in God because God scientifically has been proven, that same scientific evidence that you use to prove God's existence could tomorrow go and you say, oh, I don't believe in God anymore tomorrow. Sahih? Are you with me? Even if today scientists, all of them gained a scientific evidence that God does exist and they used their asal as God's existence, as science, guess what? That same science and that same theory that they used to believe in God's existence could tomorrow go. And then what would go? The belief of God. That's why Allah said in the Quran, بَلْهُمْ فِي شَكٍ. They are in what? They're in a state of shak, doubt, all the time. They are shakin yal'abun. They're in doubt and that's what they're playing around with. Are we all together on that? Very good. So the author, rahimahullah, he said, al-mutawatiru al-mufidu. Mutawatir is that which benefits you, knowledge which is certainty. Okay, it's certainty. That's what it benefits you. Good. Bishurutihi. The author says, but with its conditions. Oh, okay. What does the author mean, bishurutihi? He means there are four conditions. And we're going to make it five, inshallah, in total. There are five conditions that are stipulated for a narration to be what? For it to be mutawatir. For this state, for us to say this is mutawatir, it has to have how many conditions present in it? Five conditions. Okay? The first condition. Ash-shartul awwal. The first condition for this to be mutawatir is what? أَنْ يَرْوِيَهُ عَدَدٌ كَثِيرٌ. Number one, the people who narrated it have to be large in quantity. The number of narrators have to be very large. Now, within themselves, the scholars, so the first condition, let me write it. So, shurut. Shurut al-mutawatir. The first one is, أَنْ يَرْوِيَهُ أَنْ يَرْوِيَهُ عَدَدٌ كَثِيرٌ, right? The people who narrate it have to be large in number. That's the first condition. That's the first شرط. That's the first condition for it to be called mutawatir. Within themselves, the scholars differed what is a lot of number. Some said four. Some said no, five. Some said seven. Some said 10. Some said 11. Some said 40. Some said 70. And others have said others. Other statements. All of these statements, كل هذه أقوال باطلة. كل هذه الأقوال باطلة. All of these statements are null and void. It's incorrect to say that. What is right is أن التحديد غير معتبر. أن التحديد غير معتبر. That the restricting of it on number is wrong. No, don't restrict it on number. So what is it that we need when we say a lot of people narrate it? What do we mean by it? We mean al-ibra bi-ifadati hadhihi al-kathrati lil-ilm. It means when that number benefits of certainty. Remember we said that mutawatir has to be what? Al-mufidu lil-ilmi al-yaqini. It's what benefits us what? Knowledge that is certainty, right? Yes, no? Huh? It benefits us knowledge which is certainty, right? So if a number reaches benefiting a certainty, this is mutawatir. That's the بِصَرْفِ النَّظَرِ عَنْ عَدَدِهِمْ. We don't look at the number. Okay? As long as it benefits us knowledge which is certainty, then we can call this mutawatir. Sometimes little number, four narrated people might give us certainty. Sahih? Huh? Sometimes 100 may not even give us certainty. Sahih? So what gives us certainty here is what's going. That's the babid. That's it. Are you with me, all of us brothers? Huh? For example, before I go to the example, let's read the kalam of Shaykh al-Islam Taymi. Ibn Taymi says something very long. I'm going to read it all. And then, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to give the overall meaning. Because it's very long what he says, rahimahullah ta'ala.